This talk is aimed to cover the basics of cardiac failure and just to give you a good overview of the different types of cardiac failure, the different classifications and why those occur and what sort of symptoms we see with the different types. These are your learning outcomes that remember take you up to the end of phase three. So the phase three stuff is more thinking about the management. But today we will cover from these outcomes, we'll talk about acute left ventricular failure and we'll talk about chronic heart failure. And I'm also going to go into some extra detail about the different classifications of heart failure because I think it's important for you to get an understanding of, and it is something you're going to come across a lot of in clinical practice. Starting with the very basics, heart failure or cardiac failure simply refers to the failure of the pump, the heart, to meet the circulatory demands of the body. So we're simply saying that the pump don't work. And I can't say that without thinking about Bob Dylan. So here's a bit of Dylan. The pump don't work because the valve took the handle. Subterranean Homesick Blues was released in 1965, and that brings me on to my next point, that 1-2% of the population of over 65 years will have some degree of cardiac failure. Now, those that were aged 20 in 1965 when Dylan released this will now be 75 or older. And 10% of this population will now have cardiac failure. The prognosis of heart failure is often poor, particularly in severe failure, in which more than 50% of patients will die within 3 years. Let's start off with a clinical case so that this seems nice and clinically relevant to you. So you're seeing a 59-year-old gentleman. He gives you a history that he's becoming progressively short of breath over the last several months. He's found he can no longer walk down to the shops to buy a newspaper. And he's no longer sleeping in bed alongside his wife, but instead sleeps downstairs, sat upright in a chair. He's got a cough, and he tells you that he's bringing up a white frothy sputum. He also mentions to you that his wife has noticed that he's sometimes wheezing. He tells you his legs are really swollen. He's lost his appetite. He feels tired all the time, and he also feels really fed up and low in mood. He's an ex-smoker. He stopped smoking 10 years ago, but has a pack year history of 20. You ask him about his alcohol and you calculate that he's drinking approximately 70 units a week, so the equivalent of about a bottle of wine a night, 7 days a week. You ask about his family history and he tells you that he thinks his dad died of a heart attack. He was in his 80s when this happened, and his mother died of breast cancer. He's a self-employed plasterer who had been working up until the last few months when he's found he's unable to work due to his shortness of breath and fatigue. He lives with his wife, has 2 adult daughters, but tells you that he does little regular exercise. He has no past medical history and does not take any medication prescribed by his general practitioner. He tells you he occasionally takes paracetamol over the counter, but doesn't take any illicit drugs and doesn't buy any medication off the internet. So we ask about ideas, concerns, and expectations. And he tells you that he's frightened and that he's worried that it's lung cancer. So at this point, we'd stop and reflect on our history and think about what is at the top of our differentials and what some less likely differentials might be. We've taken our history, so now we want to perform a physical examination, and alongside that we'll get an ECG. The patient's ECG is an irregular rhythm with no visible P waves, and it is fast at 120 beats per minute. So we can conclude that this patient is in fast atrial fibrillation. On examination, he appears unwell. He's tachypneic with a respiratory rate of 22. His pulse is fast and irregular. He has a raised JVP. You find his heart sounds difficult to assess, but when listening to the bases of his lungs, you can hear bilateral crepitations and a mild wheeze. There also seems to be reduced air entry at the bases. You note that he has pitting edema to his mid-thighs. If this patient has been seen in A&E, the next step will be that he will be admitted to medicine, and hopefully after that he will be referred on to the cardiology team. So again, at this point, stop and think about your clinical reasoning. What is currently at the top of your differentials and what else could be happening? This is a talk on heart failure, so it really doesn't take a genius to work out that probably top of our differentials, one of those things should be heart failure. But it's also really important to note that we shouldn't rule anything out. And I would say that anybody presenting acutely unwell with breathlessness who's tachypneic, one of the things on our mind has to be excluding that patient is not septic. And one of the ways we're going to do that is by getting our blood results back. It's not unusual to see a slightly raised CRP in a heart failure patient, but this patient's white cell count and neutrophils are normal, which is reassuring that it's less likely that there's a sepsis process going on. A lactate of 1.8 is also very reassuring. We can also be reassured here that the patient's renal function is normal. You will also note that, as often happen these days in A&E when patients like this come in, that you will find that before you get to see them, they already have a troponin and a D-dimer taken and the results come back to you. And once you've seen them, we have to interpret these, and this can sometimes almost muddy the water, because again, it's not that uncommon to see someone who's got heart failure, so they've got heart dysfunction going on, to have a slightly raised troponin. This D-dimer is sort of the lower level of normal, but again, this patient isn't complaining of chest pain, either cardiac in nature or pleuritic in nature. So these results, although maybe slightly raised, are probably not something we need to worry too much about, because we can hypothesise that there's another primary process going on. This patient's chest x-ray does show a degree of pulmonary congestion and also some subtle bilateral pleural effusions. Now, don't worry too much about chest x-ray interpretation right now. We will do some more teaching on that in the future if you don't get any elsewhere. In terms of managing this patient acutely, the first things I would be thinking about is trying to get better rate control of his atrial fibrillation. I'd also be thinking about stroke risk due to his new diagnosis of atrial fibrillation and whether anticoagulation was appropriate. And then focusing on diuresis, so with medications such as furosemide initially as an inpatient. We'd then be thinking about further investigations, and very much at the top of the list here would be an echocardiogram to investigate what this patient's heart function was like. Let's now go back to learning about different types of heart failure though. And I do genuinely think this is quite a difficult topic to get your head around and to actually write a nice cohesive teaching talk on, mainly because it's just such a broad subject. You will find, if you look in your textbooks or even on the wards or in a clinical setting, people discuss heart failure in all different sorts of classifications. Firstly, you will hear about systolic heart failure and diastolic heart failure. And this has now had new terms put in alongside it. Heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, which people now sometimes abbreviate to HFpEF, and heart failure with a reduced ejection fraction. We can then also differentiate between left ventricular failure and right ventricular failure. There is also the distinction between acute heart failure and chronic heart failure. And finally, there is a very long list of causes of heart failure, which, if you attempted just to rote learn, that would be a pretty tricky job just to remember without actually understanding what is going on. On the subject of trying to understand what is going on, the first thing to say is to have a reasonable grasp of your basic anatomy and physiology of the heart. And the heart can almost neatly be divided up into a left side and a right side. So on the left side, you've got the left atrium, the left ventricle with the mitral valve in between, and then the aortic valve, which goes out into your aortic, your arterial system. On the right side, the right atrium and the right ventricle, with the tricuspid valve dividing these two, and then a pulmonary valve before you get out into the pulmonary artery. On top of having a good grasp of your basic cardiac anatomy, it's also really good to have the cardiac cycle and the components of that really securely within your mind. So we start with passive filling of both the left and right sides. At the end of that passive filling phase, you get atrial contraction. So you get an atrial kick, causing a bit of extra filling into the left and right ventricles. As the ventricles start to contract and pressure increases, the mitral and tricuspid valves close. As contraction progresses and pressure is increased further, the aortic and pulmonary valves are forced open. Blood is squeezed out into the aorta from the left ventricle and out into the pulmonary arteries from the right ventricle. As the ventricles start to relax and pressure within the ventricles decreases, blood flow starts to go back down the aorta and causes the aortic valve to close. It's also a good idea to have a reasonable grasp of the anatomy of the major veins and arteries of the body, as this is where issues with back pressure and failure in the heart will affect. The other bit of your phase one learning that I would really encourage you to revise if you've not already got a really, really good handle on is your capillary fluid dynamics. So there are two filtration forces, so forces that are going to cause fluid to move out of the capillaries into the surrounding tissues. So you have capillary hydrostatic pressure, which is to do with the pressure within the capillaries that will push that fluid out, and tissue oncotic pressure, so where you've got a oncotic gradient where fluid is attracted out of the capillaries to a region where you've got lots of sort of high protein or large molecules. And then there are two absorption forces. So firstly, tissue hydrostatic pressure. So pressure from within the tissues forcing fluid into the capillaries. And capillary oncotic pressure, where you have in your blood plasma a relatively high amount of large molecules, notably albumin, that are going to attract water to go into the capillaries. So heart failure is one of the areas of clinical medicine where capillary fluid dynamics suddenly becomes really clinically relevant. For now, let's move on to talking about the potential mechanisms of heart failure. We've already said that, put really simply, cardiac failure is simply the failure of the pump. Often it's quite useful to use an everyday analogy to understand the basic mechanisms of what's going on. The heart, after all, is simply really pipes and pumps. So if we think about it in terms of a car, if you didn't put petrol into your car, it wouldn't work. So one of the first things that could go wrong with the heart, this biological pump, is that we're not providing it with the raw material it needs. So we're not giving it any petrol. The next thing that could go wrong could be that we're simply asking it to do far too much work in comparison to what it was designed to do. Or it could just be that something has gone wrong within the pump itself. And like a car, there are many things that can go wrong. So an example of not providing it with the raw material it needs would be myocardial ischemia. So we're simply not delivering the amount of oxygen and nutrients that the heart needs to be able to continue with its function of acting like a pump. An example of asking it to do too much work could be hypertension. So the pump is having to pump against a very high resistance system, a high pressure in all the arterial system. Another simple example of this might be obesity. The larger a body mass you have, the more vessels, the more arterial system, the harder that pump is having to work to supply blood and oxygen to that entire body. And of course, there are lots of abnormalities that can occur within the pump itself. So we've got valvular disease, we've got muscle disease or cardiomyopathies, and there can also be electrical system disease that can ultimately end up in failure of the pump. So let's look at that in a bit more detail. So firstly, not providing with the raw materials needed. And we said that the example of this would be ischemic heart disease. And ischemic heart disease, so impaired flow of blood down the coronary arteries on a chronic basis usually, is the most common cause of heart failure in the developed world. Eventually, with a lack of adequate blood flow through the coronary arteries, the heart muscle will thin and become impaired, and we would refer to this as a ischemic cardiomyopathy. We would diagnose this in patients with LV systolic dysfunction when they are also found to have a prior history of myocardial infarction or revascularization. Usually these patients will have fairly significant ischemic heart disease or coronary artery disease, so more than a 75% stenosis in the left main stem or the left anterior descending artery, or they have multiple coronary arteries with significant stenoses. Thinking about asking the pump to do too much work, we said the first example would be hypertension. So in patients that have long-standing hypertension that hasn't been adequately treated, the heart is trying to pump against a high-pressure system. Initially, this is going to lead to cardiac remodeling, so you get a concentric left ventricular hypertrophy. So the muscle is thickening to cope with having to work extra hard to pump against that high-pressure arterial system. But eventually, after this compensatory mechanism of hypertrophy has been going on for a while, the heart can then actually start to fail. Obesity will lead to the heart having to do extra work. Often there are other causes in there, and this is just something that is an additive effect causing the heart to be under extra strain and can exacerbate or lead to heart failure. The other etiology that I'm going to put into this category of asking the heart to do too much work is tachycardia. So you can get a tachy-induced heart failure. Now, the actual mechanism of this type of heart failure is a bit more complicated and is actually at the moment not still fully understood. But we do certainly know that people who have been in fast tachyarrhythmias, most commonly it's atrial fibrillation. So if someone's been in AF and running at 120, 130 beats per minute, and that has remained untreated and has been going on for weeks or potentially even months, it's very common that that will lead to heart failure itself. And you can often really improve these patients' heart function simply by treating that tachycardia. It is worth noting at this point, however, when assessing patients that present with heart failure alongside a tachyarrhythmia such as fast AF, that there can be a bit of a chicken and egg scenario in that heart failure itself can lead to arrhythmias, but equally arrhythmias can lead to heart failure. And abnormality of the pump itself, and here I'm just going to focus on the cardiomyopathy, so the muscle disease. But obviously, we're talking the future. There are valve disease and electrical conduction disease that could also count as abnormalities within the pump itself that are leading to heart failure. So the first group of cardiomyopathies is dilated cardiomyopathies. So usually these patients, the entire heart is not really functioning well. So it's a global hypokinesis. So globally, there is impaired movement of the muscle wall. And usually these hearts are very dilated on echocardiogram. And the causes of these sorts of cardiomyopathies, alcohol is one of them. Another thing that we are seeing more commonly, or we see a lot in York certainly, is, and it tends to be the younger generation that present with these sorts of heart failures, is cocaine use. Usually it's a fairly substantial amount of cocaine use, but certainly if you see a patient who's, say, in their 30s who presents with sudden onset heart failure, it's really important that you get into your history a good illicit drug history. We've already talked about ischemic heart disease causing a ischemic cardiomyopathy. These are usually dilated in nature, so anyone with major long-standing multivessel coronary artery disease, that can result in a dilated cardiomyopathy. And the other category is the idiopathic category, so the patients that present with this and we actually cannot find a obvious causal factor. There are genetic cardiomyopathies, and the most common one that you will come across is a hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, which can develop if it develops obstruction of the outflow tract, so the tract going out of the left ventricle up into the aorta. We call that a hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, so you'll hear people talk about HOCM. And then there are restrictive cardiomyopathies. So these are conditions where there is a infiltration of a material or a fibrosis of the heart muscle, which thickens it and restricts it from moving. So examples of that would be cardiac amyloid or conditions such as sarcoidosis. So let's now move away from thinking about mechanisms for a bit and start talking about some of the different classifications of heart failure. There are three broad categories of classification. Firstly, the distinction between systolic failure and diastolic failure. To say these have now had more modern terms attributed to them. So that's heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, which is largely synonymous with diastolic failure, and heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, which is largely synonymous with systolic heart failure. We can then distinguish between a left ventricular failure and a right ventricular failure. And finally, there is the distinction between acute heart failure and chronic heart failure. Let's start by talking about the difference between systolic and diastolic failure. And we'll start with systolic failure. Going back to some basic physiology, cardiac output is the volume of blood pumped out per minute. We can calculate the cardiac output by multiplying our heart rate by our stroke volume. Obviously, our heart rate is the number of beats per minute. Our stroke volume is the volume of blood for each beat. In a normal person at rest, our heart rate would approximately be 70 beats per minute and our stroke volume about 70 mils. So we're pumping out 70 millilitres for each beat, of which they are 70. If we multiply that up, we've got a cardiac output of approximately 5 litres. So at rest, every minute, your heart should be beating out 5 litres of blood. We can also use our stroke volume in an equation to calculate an ejection fraction. The ejection fraction being the percentage of blood within the left ventricle that the heart manages to squeeze out for every beat. So we've already said that in health, at rest, we have a stroke volume of approximately 70 mils. So with each beat, we are pumping out 70 mils of blood. The total volume of blood in the left ventricle, again, in a sort of normal individual, will be around about 110 millilitres. So if we just divide our stroke volume of 70 millilitres by our total volume within the left ventricle of 110 millilitres, we get an ejection fraction of 64%. So 64% of the blood within the left ventricle is pumped out with each beat. This, of course, means that we have a residual volume in the left ventricle after a beat of 40 millilitres. Now imagine a scenario where your heart is able to fill nicely during diastole, so you still get a total volume of 110 millilitres within that left ventricle, but the heart is failing to pump effectively within that left ventricle. So instead of getting 70 mils of blood out with each beat, you're only getting 30 mils. If we pop these numbers into our equation, this gives us an ejection fraction of 27%. So 27% of the blood within the left ventricle is managing to be pumped out with each beat. Of course, this means our cardiac output, so the volume of blood that we're pumping out every minute, is also significantly reduced. And at this sort of level, our pump is going to be failing to meet the circulatory demands of the body. In health, our ejection fraction should be somewhere between 55 and 70%. So we're pumping out 55 to 70% of the blood within the left ventricle with each beat. If the left ventricle is only able to pump out somewhere between 45 and 54% of the blood within it, that would be a mild left ventricular systolic dysfunction. When your ejection fraction goes down between 30 and 44%, we would call this moderate left ventricular systolic dysfunction. When the left ventricle is not managing to pump out any more than 35% of the blood in it, we would count this as severe left ventricular systolic dysfunction. Let's move on to talking about diastolic failure. In diastolic failure, the issue is not with the left ventricle's ability to pump blood out, but more with the ability of the left ventricle to fill with blood. So here, imagine where we've got someone where instead of having 110 milliliters as standard in the left ventricle, that volume is down to 70 milliliters. The left ventricle may be contracting and pumping really well, but because we started with a lower total volume, the amount that it manages to pump out of a stroke volume is also reduced, say 45 milliliters. If we pop these numbers into our equation for ejection fraction, you will see we get a result of 64%. So the left ventricle is managing to pump out 64% of the total volume within it. So here the ventricle is not filling enough, so we've got a significantly reduced total volume. But our ejection fraction is preserved, so it's still sitting within that normal range of greater than 55%. However, while we have a preserved ejection fraction, we are still only pumping out 45 milliliters, so our stroke volume is 45. And if we have a heart rate of 70 beats per minute, our cardiac output is only roughly around 3 litres. And we've said that in health at rest, normally we would want that to be 5 litres. So potentially here we have a scenario where the pump is failing to meet the circulatory demands of the body because our cardiac output is too low, but there is a preserved ejection fraction. So the issue here is in ventricular diastole, when the ventricle is meant to be filling with blood. So this is either termed diastolic heart failure or heart failure with preserved ejection fraction. So just to summarise, in health, during ventricular diastole, we want our left ventricle to be filling nicely with an appropriate amount of blood, around 110 mils. And then during ventricular systole, we want our ventricle to be contracting nicely and pumping out a good stroke volume and a good percentage of the volume of blood in the left ventricle. And we'd want that to be above 55%. In diastolic heart failure, the issue is in ventricular diastole, where the ventricle should be filling, and processes such as left ventricular hypertrophy can result in there being left ventricular cavity space and therefore less blood than we would want in the left ventricle. Our left ventricular muscle function and ventricular contraction may still be good, but there's less volume in there to begin with to be pumped out. So our cardiac output and therefore our ability of the pump to meet the circulatory needs of the body may still be markedly reduced. Let's just summarise the differences between systolic and diastolic failure. So again, in health, we want nice filling of the left ventricle during ventricular diastole, and we want nice contraction of the left ventricle during ventricular systole. So we'll have a total volume of approximately 110 mils in the left ventricle at the end of diastole. The ventricle will then contract and have a stroke volume of 70 mils, and this will give us an ejection fraction of 64%. So 64% of the blood within the left ventricle is being pumped out with each beat. In diastolic heart failure, there is an impairment in ventricular diastole with the amount of volume of blood that is able to fill into the left ventricle. The systolic phase here may be normal, so the ventricle is contracting nicely, but because we started off with a lower volume in the left ventricle, there is a smaller stroke volume that is pumped out, but our ejection fraction is preserved. In systolic failure, the diastolic phase, so the filling of the left ventricle, is normal, so we have a normal volume of blood in the left ventricle. But our systolic phase is abnormal, so we have poor contraction of the left ventricle, resulting in a reduced stroke volume and consequently a reduced ejection fraction, so a smaller percentage of the total volume of blood in the left ventricle is pumped out. Let's now move on to the differences between left and right-sided failure. And we'll start with left-sided failure. And that's really what we've already been talking about. So you can either have diastolic dysfunction within the left ventricle or systolic function failure within the left ventricle. However, while we've talked about with left ventricular systolic dysfunction how our stroke volume and our ejection fraction are reduced because the ventricle is failing to contract adequately and pump enough blood out, what we haven't really discussed is what happens to all that residual blood, or what the consequence of all that residual blood within the left ventricle is. So if we're failing to pump as much blood out as is going into the left ventricle, there are not only going to be consequences in terms of our cardiac output in comparison to what our body requires, but this is also going to start to back up within the heart. So as I say, you're going to get a backup of volume into the left ventricle and left heart. And eventually that volume and pressure is going to back up into the pulmonary veins and pulmonary circulation. And this is where your capillary fluid dynamics come in. So pressure backing up into the pulmonary veins is going to back up to the capillary networks surrounding the alveoli in the lungs. That increased pressure is going to result in increased capillary hydrostatic pressure, which is a filtration force. So fluid is going to filter out of the capillaries into the surrounding space of the alveoli. So let's have a bit of a quick closer look at gas exchange in the alveoli. So we start with deoxygenated blood from the pulmonary arteries entering at one end of the capillaries. Carbon dioxide diffuses out. Oxygen diffuses in. And our oxygenated blood is then carried out to the pulmonary veins where it enters into the left atrium. So let's think about a scenario where our left ventricle is failing. we're getting increased volume and pressure within the left ventricle and then the left atrium. And that pressure is then going to back up from the left heart into the pulmonary veins. That increased pressure is going to increase the capillary hydrostatic pressure, so a filtration force, so fluid is going to move out of those capillaries in between the capillary network and the alveolars. So now in our alveolar space, we've got a layer of fluid before you can get to the capillary network. And gas exchange across that fluid barrier is going to be significantly impaired. And this is what pulmonary edema is. Hopefully now it makes sense why we see the signs and symptoms we do with a left-sided cardiac failure. So the patient may be hypoxic, short of breath, they may be coughing, they may have a pink, white, frothy sputum, and really this is going to be predominated initially by pulmonary edema if this is a simple, isolated, left-sided cardiac failure. And we should now be able to work out what sort of causes there might be of left ventricular failure. So again, I try to avoid rote learning and instead think about the sort of processes that might be going on so that you can work these out, especially in a sort of high pressure exam situation. So our left ventricle may not be pumping out adequate amounts of blood simply because it's not filling well enough. So we've got inadequate LV filling, so this would be a diastolic left-sided failure. And causes of this might be mitral stenosis. So we've got impaired flow from the left atrium into the left ventricle because that valve is very narrowed and tight. Or a process such as left ventricular hypertrophy, where that left ventricular wall is very thickened, so we're starting to obliterate that cavity space where filling would occur. Other causes of left ventricular failure may be due to pressure load. So one cause might be aortic stenosis, where you have a very tight aortic valve that the left ventricle is trying to pump against. And initially it may hypertrophy, but then it may go on to fail. Similarly, hypertension, so pumping against a high pressure system within the arteries, may initially lead to left ventricular hypertrophy, but then eventually failure. The left ventricle may fail because of volume overload, and examples of this would be in the case of aortic regurgitation and mitral regurgitation. And then, of course, there are the pathological processes within the cardiac muscle of the left ventricle. So ischemia or one of the different cardiomyopathies leading to a left ventricular muscle that is not able to contract properly and give that pumping ability that we want. Let's now talk briefly about right-sided failure. So the right heart is working to pump blood out into the pulmonary artery, this being deoxygenated blood that is then going to pass by the alveoli of the lung, where gas exchange will occur, oxygenating the blood, which will then move into the pulmonary veins and then the left atrium. Pulmonary diseases can cause a increased pressure within the pulmonary artery, so pulmonary hypertension. The right ventricle pumping against this higher pressure or resistance will eventually become impaired and fail. Like with the left side, if the right ventricle is failing to pump effectively, volume and pressure is going to back up, and this is going to back up from the right heart into the venous circulation. So it is this backup of pressure into the right ventricle and from there into the venous circulation that causes the signs and symptoms that we see in right-sided cardiac failure. So a raised JVP is simply a reflection of the pressure within the right atrium. So this will be raised. The pressure within the venous system can go into the portal veins, can cause ascites, and eventually it can cause liver cirrhosis. And the more classical, or at least easier to spot, sign of right-sided heart failure of peripheral edema. So the backup of pressure into the venous system increases your capillary fluid hydrostatic pressure, causing fluid to leak out into the interstitial space that you can see and feel as pitting edema. And this will tend to end up in places that are gravity dependent. So if the patient is sat up or walking around, it will settle out in their feet or in their legs. If they're laid flat, it can be seen as sacral edema. Causes of right heart-sided cardiac failure are generally those that are going to result in pulmonary hypertension, so lung disease, primary pulmonary hypertension, again pulmonary embolism, so clots within the pulmonary artery that the right heart is struggling to pump against. These things can all lead to right-sided heart failure. And we're going to move on now to talking about how left-sided heart failure can result in right-sided heart failure. So it's very common to start with a left ventricular failure and for this to progress to also include a right ventricular failure and give what we then term a congestive cardiac failure. So if we start with the left ventricle having impaired contraction and therefore ejection fraction, so we're not pumping up out enough blood. Volume and pressure therefore builds up on the left side. We get increased pressure in the pulmonary veins and capillaries. The increased hydrostatic pressure causes fluid leak around the alveoli. And this impairs gas exchange and results in hypoxia. Increased pressure within the pulmonary veins results in increased pressure within the pulmonary arteries. The right heart is now pumping against an increased pressure. The right heart becomes tired of pumping against this increased pressure and becomes impaired and fails. Volume and pressure backs up in the right heart as it's failing now to pump out the volume required. And now volume and pressure are backing up into the venous system, increasing capillary hydrostatic pressure and resulting in peripheral edema. And this really moves us on to our next division or classification. Because all of those processes on the right-hand side of the screen in the sort of green boxes, This is really what's going on with acute heart failure, which you can now appreciate is largely synonymous with left-sided failure. Once things have backed up from the left side to the right side, causing peripheral edema, we are now looking at a more chronic heart failure picture, which is largely synonymous with right-sided failure, but really is generally a combination of both left and right-sided failure, so a congestive cardiac picture. So let's talk briefly about the signs and symptoms of acute versus chronic heart failure. So as I said, this is largely synonymous with left-sided failure usually. So you've got a sudden failure to maintain cardiac output. There's insufficient time for compensation, and the clinical picture is dominated by pulmonary edema. Chronic heart failure is more synonymous with right-sided failure or a combination of both left and right-sided failure. So in these scenarios, there is a gradual decline in heart function, and this generally allows for compensation. And as we've just said, the chronic left ventricular failure is going to lead to pulmonary congestion and therefore pulmonary hypertension and right-sided failure. And therefore you have left and right-sided failure that are coexisting, and this we can term congestive cardiac failure. I've briefly mentioned their compensation. And so when heart failure occurs, there are generally, if time allows, compensatory mechanisms. A lot of these can become fairly unhelpful, unfortunately. Talk very briefly about this, but we can talk about it in the future when we touch on heart failure management. So we've said that heart failure is where we're failing to meet the needs of the body, so our heart is failing to pump out as much as is required. Put simply, we have a decreased cardiac output. If we have a decreased cardiac output, one of the things that this results in is a decreased blood flow to the kidneys. The kidneys then try to be really clever and attempt to restore the circulating volume. And the way they do this is by retaining sodium and water. Now, this mechanism is really great if it's a case that you and I have been out in the sunshine and we've not drunk enough water. The kidney trying to restore that volume is great. It's not so helpful in heart failure, where we're already starting to have the problem that we're backing up with too much fluid because the heart isn't effectively pumping. And it's this sort of unhelpful compensation mechanism that in part is where of a lot of the heart failure medications and treatments are focused to address. But we'll talk about that more in the future. That's it for now. Reminder of outcomes here. I'm exhausted. I imagine if you've done this in one sitting, you're exhausted too. So go take a break.